Prior to beginning the activity, please be sure to review the faculty information and disclosure statements, as well as the learning objectives. After listening to the activity, complete the post-test by clicking the Earn Credit link in the episode description. Downloadable slides and resources are also available. The following presentation is copyrighted by Medscape. No use, broadcast, or recording of this presentation, or any part thereof, is permitted without the written authorization of Medscape. The following presentation is part of a certified educational activity provided by Medscape Education and supported by an educational grant from AstraZeneca.
Hello, welcome to Medscape Oncology's Clinical Pearls for Pharmacists, BTK inhibitors for the treatment of chronic lymphocytic leukemia. I'm Matt Snyder. I'm a clinical pharmacist at Moffitt Cancer Center in Tampa, Florida. I'll be your moderator for the presentation. Joining me today as a co-panelist is Shilpa Paul. Shilpa is a clinical pharmacy specialist in leukemia at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, Texas. Welcome, Shilpa. Great to have you here today.
Thank you, Matt.
Featured here are some of the highlights that we'll touch on today in our discussion. We will plan to briefly review the current BTK inhibitors utilized for the management of CLL, in addition to a few key distinctions between various agents in regards to items like dosing and administration. We'll take a look at some of the new and exciting data coming out of the recent ASCO annual meeting and also review several clinical pearls for BTK inhibitors in general, things like drug-drug interactions, other medications to avoid, the toxicity profiles of each agent, different ways to manage adverse events, and important points to feature in patient counseling sessions. Finally, we'll take a few questions at the end of the presentation, so please feel free to submit them anytime. This slide summarizes the current FDA-approved indications for the class in CLL. Both ibrutinib and acalabrutinib have garnered approval in a variety of treatment settings, regardless of whether unfavorable features such as deletion 17P are present. Ibrutinib, on one hand, has been approved in both the frontline and relapsed refractory settings as monotherapy or in combination with various agents. Acalabrutinib, meanwhile, has received approval as a single agent or in combination with obinutuzumab for previously untreated patients, as well as monotherapy in the second-line setting or beyond. The most recent NCCN guidelines feature acalabrutinib with or without obinutuzumab and ibrutinib monotherapy as preferred options in the treatment-naive setting. This is true for patients with and without deletion 17P or TP53 mutation, with the agents being a Category 1 recommendation in cases without those abnormalities. Both agents as monotherapy are preferred Category 1 recommendations in the relapsed refractory setting as well, regardless of deletion or mutation status. Despite not yet carrying FDA approval for CLL, zanubrutinib is mentioned in the guidelines as an option for patients with intolerance to another BTK inhibitor, in most cases, ibrutinib. Now, ibrutinib is the first generation BTK inhibitor and functions by irreversibly and covalently binding to the cysteine-481 residue in the ATP binding domain of BTK. Our second generation agents also work in a similar manner to achieve irreversible and covalent inhibition. However, they tend to have much greater selectivity for BTK. While this covalent binding works very well, it can induce resistance mutations at the binding site that render the drugs ineffective. Interestingly, there's another generation of BTK inhibitors in development that work differently. Agents that are still highly selective for BTK, but they are reversible and they act independently of covalent binding to cysteine-481. It will be really interesting to watch these non-covalent inhibitors in the future, as they may have the potential to overcome those resistance mechanisms and also be useful in patients already treated with a first or second generation agent. While it is an effective inhibitor of BTK, ibrutinib also inhibits several off-target kinases, which are likely responsible for many of the characteristic toxicities we tend to see with the agent. As I mentioned, second-generation agents tend to be more selective for BTK, but they also have less off-target kinase inhibition, as you can see here from the IC50 and kinome profiling data, potentially lowering the incidence of some of those characteristic toxicities. While that often appeared to be the case in looking at adverse event rates in past studies with ibrutinib and acalabrutinib, for example, until recently, we really didn't have any head-to-head data for the two in CLL patients, which is something that Shilpa will touch on in a few slides with an update. Much research has been put into determining which toxicities result from on and off-target kinase inhibition, of which you can see a sampling here. Inhibition of BTK and other TEC family kinases are thought to impact platelet function and can contribute to the risk of bleeding we see with BTK inhibitors, while targeting of various kinases in the TEC and EGFR families have been correlated with some of the cardiac toxicities that we see. Diarrhea and rash are thought to be EGFR mediated, whereas susceptibility to infection is thought to be caused in part by inhibition of interleukin-2 inducible T cell kinase and JAK3 kinase, which have various roles in the immune system. It's the hope that understanding these mechanisms and pathways more thoroughly will help aid in drug selection and even drug development in the future, perhaps looking for or choosing agents that don't impact these pathways as much and hence have less toxicities for patients. This slide offers a brief overview of some of the general characteristics of our BTK inhibitors, most of which is really just for your reference. It's important to note some of the key PK differences between ibrutinib and its second generation counterparts. For example, we see the twice daily dosing with acalabrutinib. We see its rapid absorption and shorter half-life, its properties that really allow for greater binding site duration on BTK, achieving more complete and continuous BTK occupancy over time. And we see similar things for zanubrutinib as well. In terms of dosing, our typical population of patients in CLL may tend to be a bit older with comorbidities, perhaps having end organ dysfunction. Importantly, none of these agents typically require dose adjustment in renal impairment. As you can see though, hepatic impairment is a bit different with ibrutinib requiring adjustment in mild to moderate hepatic impairment, whereas its counterparts do not. Instead, they only have recommendations to avoid use in acalabrutinib's case or to dose reduce in zanubrutinib's case in severe hepatic impairment. And with that, I'll transition over to Shilpa for a review of some of the late-breaking results of a study comparing ibrutinib and acalabrutinib head-to-head, as well as some additional toxicity considerations.
Thank you, Matt, for that overview. So as Matt mentioned, there has been a lack of head-to-head trials amongst these BTK inhibitors, and ELEVATE relapsed refractory is the first phase 3 trial to compare the two BTK inhibitors, acalabrutinib and ibrutinib, head-to-head for efficacy and safety in patients with high-risk CLL. These were previously treated patients with CLL with at least one line of therapy and had high-risk features, so presence of 17p deletion and or 11q deletion. Patients were at least 18 years or older, had an ECOG performance status of at least 0-2. Those with significant cardiovascular disease or concomitant use of warfarin or equivalent vitamin K antagonists, prior BTK, PI3K, or BCL2 inhibitors were excluded. So 533 patients were randomized 1-1 to acalabrutinib or ibrutinib at the FDA-approved dose until progression or unacceptable toxicity. The primary endpoint for the trial was progression-free survival assessed by an independent review committee. Non-inferiority was tested after 250 events. Secondary endpoints included incidence of atrial fibrillation, incidence of treatment-emergent grade 3 or higher infections, and incidence of Richter transformation, which is a condition in which CLL changes into a more aggressive form of lymphoma, and overall survival. Baseline characteristics were well balanced. Median age was about 60 to 65. As we know, in CLL, median age of diagnosis around 70. Majority of the patients were male, had an ECOG performance status of less than 2. Approximately 45% of the patients had a deletion 17p. About 60 to 62% had a deletion 11q. Greater than 80% of the patients had an unmutated IGVH. And most patients had at least 1-3 prior lines of therapy. So again, these were relatively heavily treated patients with high-risk CLL. And as you can see, at a median follow-up of about 41 months, the independent review committee assessed the progression-free survival, and that was approximately 38 months for both BTK inhibitors, meeting their primary endpoint and establishing a non-inferiority between acalabrutinib and ibrutinib. For the secondary endpoints, ibrutinib had statistically significant higher incidence of atrial fibrillation at 16%. and compared to 9% with the acalabrutinib. So ibrutinib had 16% AFib, while only 9% of acalabrutinib, which led to actually 7 patients discontinuing ibrutinib therapy. Even in patients without history of AFib or flutter, the incidence was still higher with the ibrutinib. The incidence of grade 3 or higher infections were similar at 30% in both groups, with most common being pneumonia. There was also no difference in the rate of Richter's transformation, about 5% in ibrutinib and 4% in acalabrutinib group. When looking at adverse effects of clinical interest, ibrutinib also had statistically significant higher incidence of hypertension, bleeding of any grade, and interstitial lung disease or pneumonitis. So overall, acalabrutinib had lower cumulative incidence of AFib, hypertension, bleeding, diarrhea, and arthralgia of any grade compared to ibrutinib. So this head-to-head trial was a randomized phase 3 trial that proved acalabrutinib to be non-inferior to ibrutinib for PFS and demonstrated a more favorable safety profile, particularly for cardiovascular events such as atrial fibrillation, flutter, and hypertension. Here you can see that certain drugs that we may utilize in patients may interact with these BTK inhibitors. So we have to be very cognizant of drug-drug interaction. Certain drugs such as moderate or strong CYP3A4 inhibitors may increase serum concentration or exposure of these BTK inhibitors, lending to higher grades of toxicity. And we do want to also be careful with herbal supplements or foods that may also increase the exposure of these BTK inhibitors. Besides just looking at CYP3A4 inhibitors, inducers, we do also want to look at PJP substrates for particularly ibrutinib. So if you are using, for instance, digoxin, you want to be checking levels. If you're needing to use proton pump inhibitors for your patients, that is not recommended with acalabrutinib. They tend to say to avoid PPIs. If the patients do require antacids or H2 receptor antagonists, then acalabrutinib should be given at least 2 hours before separating at least by 2 hours with these H2RAs or antacids. Here you can also see the dose modification. So for ibrutinib, it goes to a daily dose of 280. Acalabrutinib is also just daily for moderate CYP3A4 inhibitors, and zanubrutinib also reduces from twice daily of 160 to 80 milligrams twice daily. Depending on the dose of voriconazole, posaconazole, ibrutinib does specify the dose level. Also for strong CYP3A4 inducers, we tend to avoid those with the BTK inhibitors completely. But if needing to use for the acalabrutinib, you can increase it to 200 milligrams as a CYP3A4 inducer. There are also drug classes which you may need to use with the BTK inhibitors. And again, we want to be careful because these can have overlapping toxicities. So not only could some drugs increase the serum concentration or lower the serum concentration of these BTK inhibitors, there are other medications that may overlap toxicities, particularly those that increase bleeding risk. So we tend to avoid using warfarin. In fact, most of the BTK inhibitor trials excluded use of warfarin or aspirin in their cohorts. And so even in practice, we try to avoid using certain medications that will increase bleeding risk. That includes also over-the-counter supplements for GI toxicities like acid reflux or heartburn. As I mentioned, with acalabrutinib, we want to be careful with which antacids we use and counsel our patients. With infections, there can be infection, as I mentioned earlier with the head-to-head trial and the ELEVATE, there are incidents of higher grade 3 infections, and particularly fungal infections have been documented with BTK inhibitors, particularly ibrutinib. So if you're needing to use azoles, that can be interaction with CYP3A4 inhibitors, strong or moderate, depending on which azole you use. You want to either try to avoid the use, but obviously if patients have the fungal infections, then you want to adequately reduce your BTK inhibitors appropriately. The toxicity profiles of these BTK inhibitors are really due to their kinase activity, as Matt mentioned earlier, and showed you a kinome map of these BTK inhibitors. Ibrutinib had the most off-target kinase activity, and this significantly gets reduced with the second generation in zanubrutinib and acalabrutinib, as they were specifically designed to have less off-target activity. In general, ibrutinib has higher incidence of AFib flutter, hypertension, which tends to increase over time, arthralgias and musculoskeletal pain, which in clinical practice tends to be one of the main reasons of ibrutinib discontinuation. Ibrutinib also has higher inhibitory activities on EGFR, which is linked to rash and diarrhea. Therefore, you can see higher rates of those adverse effects with ibrutinib. So in practice, we do tend to see higher rates of headaches with acalabrutinib than ibrutinib. These incidents noted in the chart are combination of CLL clinical trials that are using these BTK inhibitors. There is literature in using real-world analysis and usage of these BTK inhibitors, so you may see the incidents reported that might be slightly different in clinical practice than in clinical trials. Now, Matt will be diving a little bit deeper into a few clinically challenging adverse events that may lead to complications, and he'll discuss their management as well.
Thanks a lot, Shilpa. As she mentioned, for the next part of the presentation, we'll discuss several strategies on how to approach adverse event management and also patient education. And again, as a reminder, please feel free to submit any questions you may have, but we'll try to get to a few of them at the end of the presentation. Hypertension is a very notable adverse event associated with BTK inhibitors that has become more evident as we've accrued more long-term data on their use. While the mechanism isn't completely clear, it's thought that PI3K pathway inhibition, as well as downregulation of nitrous oxide formation and endothelial dysfunction, all may play roles. Multiple series have shown the incidence of hypertension with ibrutinib tends to increase over time. And some of the most extended follow-up data that we have on its use reported grade 3 or higher hypertension in over a quarter of patients. We even have a recent series of over 550 patients with lymphoid malignancies treated with ibrutinib on the right-hand side of your screen there, you can see, where over three quarters of patients developed new or worsened hypertension, some just a few months into therapy. Now, as Shilpa mentioned, while the rates of hypertension with acalabrutinib do seem to be lower, it can still be an issue, and it's something that we definitely need to monitor closely for and be proactive about. Shilpa, what are some things you like to focus on when managing blood pressure in your practice for patients, whether they're about to begin a BTK inhibitor or they're already on an agent?
Thanks, Matt. So we, you know, at MD Anderson, we, due to these BTK inhibitors and their toxicity profiles, one of the main things that we want to make sure is that our patients are compliant with these BTK inhibitors, because if you're using them as monotherapy, they need to be used continuously. So we want to make sure that we are decreasing or managing the toxicities well enough that they remain compliant and they're seeing those outcomes that we see in the trials if they're taking them twice a day or daily and being compliant. As I mentioned, acalabrutinib in the CLL trials might have a lower incidence, but in clinical practice, we tend to see a little bit higher rate of hypertension. Most of the patients really just require one agent. If there is a patient that has a prior history of hypertension and is already on three, you know, antihypertensive medications, we tend to have cardiology on board to manage them better. Another thing that we also make sure is the type of antihypertensive we're using, we're making sure that it doesn't have a drug-drug interaction, whether PJP or any kind of CYP3A4 inhibition with the BTK inhibitors. Usually the hypertension tends to stay around grade 1 or 2. It's highly unlikely that we're unable to control the blood pressure with just antihypertensives.
Thanks, Shilpa. I think you made some great points there. And I think one thing from our perspective too, it is really important, as you mentioned, if you need to coordinate care with the patient's outside cardiologist or primary care physician, just to make sure that they do have great continuity of care. And it's something that we're keeping tabs on consistently throughout their treatment course. Okay, atrial fibrillation is something that has been found to be more prevalent in patients at baseline with untreated CLL than the general population. And it's become an even bigger issue with patients on BTK inhibitors as we've gathered up more follow-up data on their use. Although the mechanism for BTK inhibitor-related AFib is not completely clear, it's thought that inhibition of PI3K signaling, which acts as a critical regulator of cardiac protection under stress, is regulated by BTK and TEC. And when we inhibit those kinases, we can see our patients develop AFib and have issues. Multiple reports have established this risk with BTK inhibitors and found patients who tend to be older or who have several other comorbidities or prior history of AFib or cardiac disease, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, all to be at higher risk of developing AFib. Various approaches for management are described in the literature, and while a few minor facets may differ, depending on the reference or the resource that you look at, a lot of their core tenets are the same. Shilpa, how do you typically like to assess and manage patients who develop AFib while on a BTK inhibitor? And is there anything in particular that you think is very important from a pharmacist perspective to look at?
Yeah, so AFib, you know, initially when ibrutinib came out and it had this rate of atrial fibrillation, it became very clinically challenging. As you had mentioned earlier, this tends to be higher, you know, older age group of patients. They tend to have more comorbidities. A lot of these comorbidities include sometimes AFib and hypertension. And so I just want to note that atrial fibrillation is not a contraindication to using these BTK inhibitors. You just need to be more careful and monitor these patients more closely. So again, we would have cardiologists and work with them in managing atrial fibrillation. The great advantage of the second generation like zanubrutinib and acalabrutinib is that they have lower incidence of atrial fibrillation. So we do see that in clinical practice, most physicians tend to favor acalabrutinib now than ibrutinib due to lower cardiovascular risks or you know, toxicities with acalabrutinib, such as hypertension and AFib. The other thing with atrial fibrillation, if it does occur, which it can with acalabrutinib, but just at a lower incidence, some of these patients that do need anticoagulation, and we know that these patients can be at high risk with BTK inhibitors of bleeding, is we tend to use apixaban and less of enoxaparin or other agents. I'm not sure, Matt, what you guys prefer at your institution, but we tend to sometimes even do a lower dose of apixaban. We want to make sure that these patients are not, you know, old and frail and at risk for falling and having, you know, subdural hematomas and hemorrhages. So all of those consideration of the patient's profile, what medications, what kind of comorbidities they have, and whether it would be appropriate to use BTK inhibitor in these patients versus a completely different class of drugs.
Thanks, Shilpa. Yeah, I agree. That's pretty consistent with what we do in our practice typically as well, evaluating these patients' bleeding risk as well as, you know, looking at their chest VAS score. And then typically for anticoagulation, yeah, we will usually stick with a direct oral anticoagulant such as apixaban. And I think too, for pharmacists, the big thing is just to make sure that we avoid drug interactions in some of our solutions to these problems. So for example, instead of, you know, verapamil or diltiazem, avoiding those agents, but like perhaps beta blocker, metoprolol, if you're considering a rate control approach.
Correct. And herbal and supplements are also very important. We recently, because of these oral agents, recently started a pharmacy-led clinic where we call patients to follow them out for adverse effects. And just as long as you're able to counsel your patients ahead of time, it will be amazing to see how empowered patients are if you counsel them about certain type of adverse effects that can occur. And they tend to be, when those adverse effects do occur, they tend to, you know, ask or call physicians or reach out and able to tolerate or manage their adverse effects much better. And so atrial fibrillation or telling them of bleeding risk and not taking over-the-counter NSAIDs or an aspirin over-the-counter can really also help reduce the risk of bleeding.
Yeah, those are great points. And yeah, speaking of bleeding, it's been found that our patient population of CL in general, they tend to have less robust platelet aggregation than healthy controls. And on top of that, with BTK inhibitors, inhibition of BTK and other TEC family kinases can affect platelet aggregation and also strongly impact platelet adhesion on von Willebrand von Willebrand factor. So these patients are definitely at higher risk of bleeding with BTK inhibitors, particularly more so ibrutinib. It may be pretty common, but typically the bleeding or bruising that we see is usually low grade. So major bleeding tends to occur much less frequently. However, the risk has been found to be increased with the use of anticoagulant or antiplatelet agents, particularly dual therapy, which is important to note as patients could be on some of these agents very commonly. Shilpa, what are some key points? I know you mentioned a few when we were in our prior discussion, but for managing this issue with BTK inhibitors, how do you typically go about assessing bleeding in these patients?
Yeah, Matt, I would echo what you just said. You know, grade 3 or higher tends to be much lower. We tend to see just grade 1 or 2 where we don't really have to do anything. Do we just continue to monitor the patient again? Initially, when we prescribe, we counsel the patients that this is a possibility. So we don't tend to like hold the BTK inhibitors if it's just grade 1 or 2. Most of the patients will just have BTKA. If they are requiring a procedure or undergoing a procedure, then usually for something major, we will hold the BTK inhibitor for 7 days or tell the patient to hold it for 3 days if they tend to be minor. There are studies showing that if you hold a BTK inhibitor for greater than 7 or 8 days, it can impact outcomes. So we want to be very careful. And again, counseling and letting the patients know when they have certain procedures to let you know or your clinic or physicians know so that they can adequately counsel the patients on how to hold the BTK inhibitor.
Thanks. Those are great points. Moving on, I think this slide is a really great reference for some different approaches to managing other common BTK inhibitor-related toxicities. Many of these patients can easily implement on their own, and they have great utility in preventing these toxicities from getting out of hand or causing interruptions in therapy. Shilpa, are there any here in particular you typically like to focus on or recommend when counseling the patients or that you really find to be helpful in your practice?
Yeah, so most of these are self-limiting. As I mentioned, there are few. Headache can be persistent and hypertension can actually increase over time with these BTK inhibitors. Most of them are self-limiting, like rash and diarrhea. Usually they are median onset of times around 6 months. So particularly with ibrutinib, we can see diarrhea and bedtime dosing has helped patients, good hydration. We don't frequently need to use loperamide, but it is another agent that we could use. Headaches, as we kind of mentioned earlier, can be issued a little bit more for acalabrutinib than ibrutinib in clinical practice. Again, very important to tell them to avoid NSAID aspirin. And then we usually discuss with a physician as to what agent they want to use. And then arthralgias, myalgias tends to be the most common reason for discontinuation in clinical practice for ibrutinib. Exercise, again, avoiding those NSAIDs and alternative supplements or, you know, tonic water and those kinds of things may help the patient, or light-bearing exercise sometimes does as well. So I think these are definitely, again, counseling points for your patients that they can, as you mentioned, Matt, integrate into their life on their own, you know, allowing them to have better quality of life since they have to take these BTK inhibitors continuously.
Yeah, no, I completely agree, Shilpa. Really great, great points. One other common occurrence to touch on quick that I think is worth mentioning with BTK inhibitor therapy is the asymptomatic lymphocytosis that we tend to see when we start the agents. So BTK, it transmits signals from chemokine receptors and adhesion molecules called integrins that organize B cell migration and homing to the lymphatic tissues. When you inhibit these homing receptors, we get the basis for this lymphocytosis, which really results in the mobilization of CLL cells from secondary lymphatic organs to the peripheral blood. And this will cause the white count to increase by a factor of 2 to 3-fold or even perhaps more during the first weeks of therapy in most patients, typically peaking after about 1 to 2 months. On occasion, it can persist for longer periods of time. More often than not, it'll resolve during the first couple months of therapy. And most importantly, really, it's not a sign of resistance or a suboptimal response or even predictive of a worse prognosis. These patients rarely require any intervention. The main point here, clinically speaking, is just to be able to recognize this process and what's going on and continue on BTK inhibitor therapy as planned. Now, adherence plays a very important role in the success of BTK inhibitor therapy as well. Multiple studies have demonstrated that extended interruptions in therapy with ibrutinib could have a potential negative impact on outcomes. It's very good to make patients aware what to do if they miss a dose, which you can see on the right-hand side of your screen. However, I think it's really much more effective to take preventive measures as well to ensure doses aren't missed. And we can do this by, as pharmacists, by helping patients overcome barriers, both financial and patient-related. So in terms of financial barriers, these drugs tend to be very costly, and they're also continuous therapies. So not just ensuring that your patient can gain access to the drug initially through prescription assistance programs, grants, other institutional resources, but being sure that they can continue to stay on therapy and can continue to receive the drug. The other thing is in terms of patient-related barriers, I think pharmacists play a really big role here in terms of education and follow-up throughout the patient's care, in terms of helping them realize how important adherence is, giving them adherence tips in terms of dosing calendars or checklists if they need it, and of course, educating them on adverse event management so that they can control those and stay on therapy. Shilpa, what barriers, financial or patient-related, do you find particularly important for pharmacists to focus on? And is there any ways, particularly that you like to address them?
So I think that financial barrier is less if we are using them for FDA-approved usage. So we don't tend to have a lot of financial barriers with the BTK inhibitors if we're using them appropriately. Although I will say the manufacturers do have great programs for these patients if needed. The other thing, as you mentioned, for patient adherence, the biggest thing is being preventative. So counseling them, letting them know what are some of the common adverse effects and the ones that, are self-limiting versus some that may continue on and so forth, and can, checking in on the patients and having a collaborative practice with other physicians such as cardiovascular. We would need a cardiology, specialist. And then also, I would say that for adherence, you do want to look at the patients themselves. So if patients have huge adherence problem and they don't have a lot of comorbidities, you might want to use a ibrutinib that's once daily versus a acalabrutinib that's twice daily. So those smaller details can impact the patient's outcome if they have certain issues or comorbidities. So you do want to look at the patient and then select the appropriate BTK inhibitor.
Thanks, Shilpa. Patient education is really important as well, as we've mentioned. I think from the get-go, making them aware of what adverse events to expect so they know what to look out for ahead of time, helping them differentiate which side effects are minor and can be managed on their own versus which side effects are major and need to be reported to the medical team right away so that they can seek medical care. I think from a non-toxicity related perspective, there are several education points that are important to hit as well. Teaching patients to make sure that they report all their new medications to us so we can be sure to avoid interactions, or if they're planning any surgical procedures so we know when to hold the BTK inhibitor. Even dietary considerations as well so they can avoid any interacting foods. Shilpa, are there any other points that you typically like to hit in your counseling sessions besides these?
Matt, I think all of these are very important, and I agree with you. We keep harping on the preventative aspect and counseling the patient. Always, when you have an interaction with your patients reviewing, I always tend to ask not only what new prescriptions they have started, but also what herbals and supplements. Oftentimes, patients, don't think of them as medications, and also just for particularly diarrhea, sometimes we can make dietary, or for acid reflux or heartburn, we can make some dietary changes for the patient to better tolerate the BTK inhibitor. So I think these are all very important imperative points.
Great points. One last thing here. Acquired resistance to our current BTK inhibitors is most commonly mediated by a couple of mutations. One in the BTK binding site, particularly a cysteine to serine substitution at position 481, that confers clinical resistance by reducing covalent binding, and a second activating mutation in the protein immediately downstream of BTK, phospholipase C gamma 2, which results in pathway activation that's independent from BTK. Whatever the cause of resistance, it's very important to highlight the distinction between resistance and intolerance with our current BTK inhibitors. So both of our second generation agents have been shown to be well tolerated with high response rates in patients previously intolerant to ibrutinib, with most of the toxicities that forced the switch to begin with either not recurring or doing so at a much lower grade. So patients can continue to stay on a BTK inhibitor. However, these second generation agents still have the same mechanism as ibrutinib and are dependent upon covalent binding at that cysteine 481 site, rendering them, like ibrutinib, susceptible to resistance via these mutations. Shilpa, would you like to elaborate a bit on screening for these mutations, if there are any situations in which it may be useful or has a role in your practice or institution specifically?
Yeah, so we don't tend to screen initially. Obviously, if you start seeing that the patient has stopped responding to the BTK inhibitor, as Matt mentioned earlier, there's the asymptomatic, you know, lymphocytosis earlier on, but after several months after therapy, if the patient had a response and then started losing the response, this is where we would check for those mutations or intolerance or resistance to the BTK inhibitors. So they are upon subsequent failure of BTK inhibitors and not initial, and that's when we would be testing and changing therapy accordingly.
I completely agree. And I think one final point to make in the case of resistance, if you have a patient who is overtly progressing on a BTK inhibitor, it may be tempting to stop the agent. However, this could lead to rapid disease growth and perhaps even clinical deterioration of your patient. So it's really important to recognize that BTK inhibitors should not be stopped immediately in this situation, and instead are best continued until the patient is ready to proceed with the next line of treatment. And in many circumstances, these may even overlap slightly. But just another point to make in patients who have progressed on BTK inhibitor therapy.
That's a very important point, Matt.
All right, so to sum things up, BTK inhibitors play a large and ever-expanding role in the management of CLL, both in the frontline and relapsed refractory setting. Pharmacists are really, really important for patient education on the adverse events of BTK inhibitors, helping patients know what to look out for, helping them manage them on their own, and being able to stay on therapy. Pharmacists are also a really important part of the medical care team in determining the plan for adverse event management, avoiding drug-drug interactions, or the use of agents that may have toxicities that worsen some of the adverse events that we tend to see with BTK inhibitors. And then finally, Shilpa talked about a lot of the data with the ELEVATE study, but we need to continue to follow this data and other comparative studies to help further delineate differences and preferences between available BTK inhibitors. As also we await some of the data on the BTK inhibitors with novel mechanisms to see what their role in therapy will be in the future. And with that, take a look and see if we can find some questions here from the audience. Is anticoagulant therapy needed if the BTK inhibitor is already having an antiplatelet anticoagulant activity? So I'm guessing this would be, you know, perhaps in a patient with AFib or a patient even with a DVT. Would you like to comment on that, Shilpa?
Yeah, so it all depends on the CHA2DS2 score and the HAS-BLED score to determine where the patient's risk lies, whether they need to have anticoagulation or antiplatelet therapy with the BTK inhibitor. So I think it really will depend on the patient's risk factor versus just baseline, if I understand the question correctly.
Yeah, no, correctly. I agree, definitely. I think you have to assess a lot of those factors at baseline and just see whether or not the patient is a good candidate for anticoagulation in that setting. So there's a lot of really variables that come into play there that need to be assessed. I think that's all the time that we have for today. We want to thank you very much for our audience for joining us today and listening in. Thanks to Medscape as well for letting us review these agents here today. Take care, everyone. And thank you, Shilpa, as well for your time and going through everything.
Thank you, Matt.